Good afternoon. I'd like to introduce my guest, if I may, take the opportunity. First of all, I will say this. To look about this room, to see so many people who have been a very large part of my life since I came to Chapel Hill as a freshman in 1970 and then became a part of the community in 1977. A lot of people, I look around, thank you so much for taking me in and looking after me. Very much appreciated, very much appreciated. It's also very rewarding to look out here and see a lot of students that I had the pleasure of teaching at Chapel Hill High School, of which Luke is one of the most recent additions, and thinking, wow, for all the time they spent with me, I didn't mess them up. So you guys are really nice to have. One last question. How many of you were born in the North? Please raise your hand. Wow. How many of you were born south in the south of the Mason-Dixon line? Okay, you guys are going to get the southern version today. You outnumber. And my guest. I was getting around to that. Thank you. This is my lady, Miss Karen McCall. If you'll please stand. She puts up with a lot. And I will brag on her a little bit. She just competed a couple of weeks ago in an Ironman, a half Ironman. She swam 1.2 miles. She rode a bicycle for 56 miles. And then she ran for 13.1 miles. In her age group of 37 contestants, she finished first in swimming, seventh in bicycle, seventh in running, overall fifth. Karen McCall. Yeah, she probably did. That's probably true, Lance. Thanks for being here. Everybody. In the aftermath and great times after the great and terrible Battle of Gettysburg, people north and south wondered, what did it all mean? With good reason. For back in July, over the course of 3 days of battle, there had been over 50,000 casualties. And now, by November of 1863, with the two armies shadow boxing down in Virginia, the Union victory at Gettysburg seemed distant. It seemed empty. Indeed, distant seemed the fighting which had taken place around the Lutheran Seminary, Cemetery in Culp's Hill, the Round Tops, Seminary Ridge, and Cemetery Ridge. Those once tranquil settings were the stage for horrific warfare. Over 3 days, it has been estimated that 569 tons of ammunition had been fired over the course of 3 days. And after the battle, the 2,400 townspeople of Gettysburg were left with 10 times its population in wounded. Over 20,000 soldiers wounded had been left behind, and one-third of them were Confederate. Every structure in town was a field hospital. Curtains used for bandages, bloodied books for pillows. To handle the human holocaust, the Union Army of the Potomac left behind 106 medical officers and the Confederate Army of Northern Virginia, perhaps 80 to 90 surgeons. Surgeons, volunteer nurses, worked to and beyond the point of exhaustion. The volume of suffering so great that the Christian Commission and Sisters of Charity rushed to the town. The Union officer in charge of the United States Military Railroad, Herman Haupt, made certain his crews had the York and Cumberland Railroad in efficient working condition. Over that line, on July 9th alone, cars transported more than 1,000 wounded to nearby Baltimore, Maryland. On July the 12th, 1,219 more were delivered. More than half were Confederate soldiers. The significance of the greatest battle in North American history was not lost also upon the photographers. They came, and they documented Historians with cameras like Alexander Gardner, Timothy O'Sullivan, James F. Gibson, and Matthew Brady. The first three, Gardner, O'Sullivan, and Gibson, arrived as early as the afternoon of July the 5th, before all the dead had been buried. The three found illustrator-artist Alfred Ward of Harper's Weekly and Edwin Forbes of Frank Leslie's illustrated newspaper, both furiously sketching to try to convey the carnage. All recorded on sketch paper and film, the 19th century's complete fascination with death. All brought the heartbreak, hell, and destruction of war back to sitting parlors and living rooms, back in far removed northern homes. And it wasn't only human. It is estimated that some 5,000 dead horses and mules were gathered together and put to the torch. Adding to the nightmare of battle, some 8,000 bodies were scattered everywhere. At the foot of the Round Tops, the Rose Farm, Devil's Den, the Wheat Field, McPherson's Ridge, so much so that, quite simply, the stench was overpowering. Windows in town were closed, even in the heat of summer. Citizens carried on their persons bottles of pennyroyal or peppermint oil. In short time, many of the dead were hastily buried, but only under a thin covering of earth, some not deep enough to escape scavenging pigs and hogs. Something had to be done, and Gettysburg citizen David McConaughey took on the task. He was president of the Evergreen Cemetery Association, and he wrote Pennsylvania Governor Andrew Curtin. He proposed, and I quote, "the most liberal arrangements with our cemetery for the burial of our own dead and the dead of all the loyal states whose sons fell in the glorious strife." That idea suddenly expanded when Governor Curtin named 32-year-old Judge David Wills to be his agent on the scene. Wills had studied law with Pennsylvania Congressman Thaddeus Stevens. A successful attorney, Wills owned the largest house in the town square. 3 weeks after the battle, Judge Wills reported to Governor Curtin, "In many instances, arms and legs and sometimes heads protrude, and my attention has been directed to several places where the hogs were actually rooting out the bodies and devouring them." That message provoked a message to Washington, and the War Department jerked into action. They shipped in thousands of caskets. Contracts went out to bury or rebury the slain. And yes, that included Confederate dead, which had to be identified and, where found, buried deeper. 34 groups bid. The highest was $8 per corpse. The winning offer was $1.59 per body. The average they hoped to put into the ground, 100 bodies a day. The goal, to get the bodies into the ground between the first frost and the ground freezing. But the task proved too great. The rate could not be maintained, and so completion was pushed back to the next spring. When done, 3,512 Union soldiers were interred in what became known as the Soldiers' National Cemetery. Some 1,600 of them unknown. And again, yes, that meant some Confederate soldiers inadvertently were included in the new Soldiers' Cemetery. For the land to be used, money was raised from an interstate commission, which purchased 17 acres for the new cemetery in the name of the state of Pennsylvania. Its design followed a rural cemetery, a new trend. The Greek word for cemetery means sleeping place. And this new design, the rural cemetery, reflected just that. Rural architect William Saunders was hired to design the cemetery's layout. Trained in Scotland, He was employed by the United States Department of Agriculture. His plan included graded inclines, great curving ranks that gave equality to all the loyal states. And for a fitting dedication service, Judge Wills asked poets Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, John Greenleaf Whittier, and William Cullen Bryant for an original work. None complied. They thought their efforts not equal to the task of what needed to be done. So therefore, a powerful oration was needed, one to last a couple of hours or so. Since Massachusetts Senator Daniel Webster's passing, the natural choice was Edward Everett, a scholar. He was the former president of Harvard, who was described by Ralph Waldo Emerson as the master of eloquence. He was also the former governor of Massachusetts and minister to England under President John Tyler. He also served as Millard Fillmore's Secretary of State. Everett's delivery was dramatic as was his diction and gestures. He memorized every word of his carefully written text. No stranger to this sort of speech or oration, he had already made speeches on battlefields, at Lexington, at Concord, at Bunker Hill. Yes, for this dedication service at Gettysburg, Edward Everett was perfect. He was invited September the 23rd and scheduled to appear October 23rd. However, he found he needed more time for preparation. So the dedication ceremony was moved back to Thursday, November 19th. By the way, another invitation, quite casually, went out to another, the 16th President of the United States. Abraham Lincoln was invited by Judge Wills on November the 2nd to, as he put it in his letter, formally set apart these grounds to their sacred use by a few appropriate remarks, and performed this last best solemn act to the soldiers dead on this battlefield. The afterthought to include the president should not be considered a slight, not an insult. Federal responsibility was not expected in this state activity, and Lincoln himself did not take offense. He actually thought it was a wonderful opportunity and appreciated the invitation because he thought the trip and the speech would be good for political fence mending in the state of Pennsylvania. And so, Secretary of War Edwin Stanton arranged for a 6 a.m. train for the 80-mile trip and noon affair. Anticipating a huge crowd, Lincoln decided to leave the day before, on the 18th. The journey would take 6 hours, with transfers in Baltimore, Maryland, and Hanover Junction, Pennsylvania. The early departure did upset someone, Mary Todd Lincoln, who was hysterical over her son Tad's illness, suffering from a high fever. She was still traumatized by the untimely death of her 11-year-old son, Willie, who had died of typhoid fever some 20 months earlier, back in February of 1862. And there were others who smelled death, political death. It was Judge David Wills' acidic mentor, Pennsylvania Congressman Thaddeus Stevens, who thought the 16th President Abraham Lincoln was nothing more than a dead card in the Republican Party deck. Of Lincoln's invite, Stevens commented, and I quote, "Let the dead bury the dead." When Lincoln heard of Stevens' barb, he responded, "These comments constitute a fair specimen of what has occurred to me throughout life. I have endured a great deal of ridicule without much malice, and have received a great deal of kindness not quite free of ridicule. I am used to it." Beyond the demands of wrestling with civil war, the president had been busy. There had been the wedding of Salmon Chase's beautiful daughter, Kate. There had been an urgent visit from New York politico Thurlow Weed, who had suggested to the president of a 90-day armistice between contesting sides. And the president was also working on his annual year-end message to Congress. But no matter, despite all the busy schedule, the president and his entourage left around noon of November the 18th. It was a four-car train which carried members of the cabinet, Army and Navy officers, French and Italian ministers, and all swapped stories until nearing Hanover Junction. And then Mr. Lincoln excused himself with, "Gentlemen, this is all very pleasant, but the people will expect me to say something to them tomorrow, and I must give the matter some thought." Upon arrival at dusk in Gettysburg, Judge Wells and Edward Everett met the president and escorted him the two blocks from the train station to the town square in Gettysburg where Wells' home was. Lincoln's black servant, William Slade, took his baggage up to the second story, and the president stayed in a room that looked out into the town square. Ironically, Thaddeus Stevens' old law office was just across the way. While Lincoln prepared, his young secretaries, John Hay, John Nicolay, and their traveling companion, Edwin Stanton, Jr., visited and explored the town. With D.C. journalist John Forney, they made slightly intoxicated impromptu speeches down in the streets. One group of people cheered one of Forney's monologues. And as they did, Forney's mood turned, and he challenged them. "You have no such cheers to your president down the street? Do you know what you owe that great man? You owe your country. You owe your name as American citizens." A crowd did gather at the Wills home, and serenaded, Lincoln emerged from the front door. And he said, "In my position, it is somewhat important that I should not say foolish things." And someone from the crowd blurted, "If you can help it." As was his routine, Mr. Lincoln ignored the comment and begged off from making the speech and went back inside the house. Inside, crowded. Governor Curtin and Edward Everett almost had to sleep in the same bed. Everett's daughter did indeed sleep in the same bed with two other women, and under their weight, it collapsed during the night. The architect, William Saunders, of the cemetery, he slept downstairs, and it was so crowded he sat on a sofa and had to sleep sitting upright. The next morning, President and Secretary of State Seward toured the battlefield. About his speech, the president seemed almost cavalier about what he would say. He was a wordsmith. He was a slow writer, and he composed his thoughts most carefully. Politically, he admired Thomas Jefferson. Oratorically, he admired the former senators Daniel Webster of Massachusetts, Henry Clay of Kentucky, and John C. Caldwell of South Carolina. Dawn, Thursday, November the 19th, 1863, it promised a bright and pleasant day. At the cemetery, as to the goal of burying all of the dead, only about one-third of the task had been completed. In fact, the whole burial site was quite incomplete. No matter, the ceremonies proceeded as planned. Despite some confusion and delay, the procession to the cemetery began to form out on the town square around 10 a.m. in the morning. Mr. Lincoln emerged with his silk top hat, around it still a mourning band for Willie. Other than white gloves, he was dressed completely in black. Once astride his horse, he sat gracefully. But waiting for the procession to begin, and as time elapsed, he began with his 6'4" frame to slump. About 11 o'clock, the column finally began to move. Behind him in the procession, there were the governors of 6 of the 18 participating states. There were cabinet members like William Seward. And there were officers who had been at the Battle of Gettysburg, like Major General Abner Doubleday and Brigadier General John Gibbon. With the procession finally underway, it ran straight south from the square, down Baltimore Street. Ironically, the same route Confederate soldiers, after occupying the town on the morning of July the 1st, had used some 4 months earlier. Awaiting the procession, an estimated 15 to 20,000 people. The speaker's platform was, by design, set some distance from the burial operations. To be quite honest, we still do not know for certain where the president gave exactly his address that day. Finally, the program began with music by Bergfield's band. Then was followed a prayer by Reverend T.H. Stockton, Doctor of Divinity, whose text for his prayer was 4 times the length of Lincoln's address. Then came music from the Marine Band. Now Everett rose to take the podium. He had arrived early to prepare in a tent behind the platform. At age 69, he suffered from kidney trouble and used the tent to relieve himself before the 3-hour ceremony. His thick manuscript sat on a little table before him, and he ostentatiously refused to look at it. With a voice that was described as sweet and perfectly modulated, he began, "Standing beneath this serene sky, overlooking these broad fields now reposing from the labors of the waning year, the mighty Alleghenies dimly towering before us, the graves of our brethren beneath our feet, it is with hesitation that I raise my poor voice to break the eloquent silence of God and nature." Introduction delivered, he now plunged into the body of his speech. He outlined the beginning of the war, reviewed the 3-day battle, discussed and denounced state sovereignty, gave historical and classical allusions. He quoted the ancient Athenian Pericles, "The whole earth is the sepulcher of illustrious men." While he spoke, the president at various times took a copy of his remarks from his coat pocket, put on his steel-rimmed spectacles, and read over his speech. After some 2 hours, Everett threw back his head and concluded with, "But they, I am sure, will join us in saying, as we bid farewell to the dust of these martyr heroes, that wheresoever throughout the civilized world the accounts of this great warfare are read, and down to the latest period of recorded time, in the glorious annals of our common country, there will be no brighter page than that which relates the Battle of Gettysburg." He turned and went back to his seat. After 2 hours of oration and some 13,508 words, he might well have assured and assumed that he had delivered a speech for the ages. Indeed, if he did, the prolonged applause had to reinforce that belief. After the featured oration, there was more music and a hymn composed by B.B. French, Esquire, performed by the Baltimore Glee Club. Then finally, it was time for the president's few appropriate remarks. Ward Lehman, Lincoln's bodyguard, moved to the podium and with great understated simplicity announced, "The President of the United States." That was the introduction. The president rose. He ambled to the front of the platform, and in his high-pitched tenor, that carried and was clearly heard. He began to slowly read, as one reporter put it, in a sharp, unmusical voice. Presidential Secretary John Hay, however, remembered Lincoln's delivery carried more grace than usual. The president was interrupted 5 times by applause, its length between 2 and 3 minutes, and was delivered, as one person put it, with almost shocking brevity. When he finished, many of the 15 to 20,000 had to think, "Is that it?" Speech complete, there was a pregnant pause, and then long, polite, continued applause. Now came a dirge sang by a choir, and then to close, a benediction by Reverend H.L. Barher, Doctor of Divinity. Dedication over, all returned to the Wills for lunch, and an unscheduled reception which required the president to shake hundreds of hands for about an hour. The final event was a patriotic rally held at the Gettysburg Presbyterian Church. At day's end, an exhausted president boarded the train with his party at about 6:30 in the afternoon. After his speech, and throughout most of the afternoon's events, the president seemed listless, almost gloomy. Now on the train, weariness set in. He stretched out on one of the side seats in the car's drawing room with a wet folded towel across his eyes and forehead. Back at the executive mansion in Washington City, around midnight, he was relieved that Tad's fever had broken, but now he had to battle a medical complication himself. He was diagnosed with varioloid, a mild form of smallpox. Kept isolated the next day from business and office seekers, Lincoln mused, "Well, there is one good thing about all of this. I now have something I can give everybody." In the coming days, however, reviews started to roll in about his address. And perhaps you may be surprised that they were mixed. From matter of fact, John Hay, the presidential secretary, wrote of the day, "Mr. Everett spoke as he always does perfectly, and the president, in a firm, free way, with more grace than is his wont, said his half dozen lines of consecration, and the music wailed, and we went home through crowded and cheering streets," and all the particulars are in the daily papers. To complimentary, a Cincinnati editor reviewed the speech, "The right thing in the right place, and a perfect thing in every respect." To biting, the Chicago Times wrote the next day, "The cheek of every American must tingle with shame as he reads the silly, flat, and dishwatery utterances of a man who has to be pointed out to intelligent foreigners as the President of the United States." A Sidney George Fisher, out in the crowd, he wrote, "The orator was Edward Everett. His speech was long, but commonplace, though well written and appropriate. Mr. Seward made a good speech. Mr. Lincoln a very short one, but to the point, and marked by his pithy sense, quaintness, and good feeling." Perhaps the greatest critique came from Edward Everett himself, who wrote the very next day, the 20th. He wrote requesting a copy of Mr. Lincoln's speech, and then he volunteered this opinion. "Mr. President, permit me to express my great admiration of the thoughts expressed by you with such eloquent simplicity and appropriateness at the consecration of the cemetery. I should be glad if I could flatter myself that I came as near to the central idea of the occasion in 2 hours as you did in 2 minutes." 2 minutes. 10 sentences. 272 words. We all know Mr. Lincoln began with 47 years ago. It was a phrase borrowed from Psalms chapter 90, a chapter attesting to suffering and resurrection, and an 1861 speech given by Galusha H. Grow of Pennsylvania in the House of Representatives, who opened his speech that day with 45 years ago. Lincoln ended his address after complex melodic pairings with a strong row of monosyllables, of, by, and for the people. It was an effect that the president particularly liked. That phrase was borrowed from one of the most militant transcendentalists, Theodore Parker, a man who had mastered 20 languages, gave money to the abolitionist John Brown, and whose grandfather fought on the green at Lexington. Parker used the triple refrain constantly when he spoke about government, and most assuredly influenced Abraham Lincoln. Throughout the address, there were no proper names, no particulars, no sides, no local references, not even the name of the battle or the cemetery was mentioned. There was also no mention of slavery, constitutionality, sectionalism, property, or states. For Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address expressed ideals. It resembled classic Athenian funeral oration and was filled with classical rhetoric. The fitting, the democratic burial of soldiers, romantic imagery of birth and rebirth expected at the dedication of rural cemeteries. It made use of biblical vocabulary to trumpet a nation's consecration, its suffering and resurrection. And it played upon a culture of death that made mourning serve life. Historian Gary Wills wrote in his 1992 Pulitzer Prize-winning Lincoln at Gettysburg, "The president performed one of the most daring acts of open-air sleight of hand ever witnessed by the unsuspecting. Everyone in the vast throng of thousands was having his or her intellectual pocket picked. The crowd departed with a new thing in its ideological luggage." Quite simply, the speech was made compact and compelling by its ability to draw on so many sources of verbal energy. It was straightforward, yet it was magical. Yet once again, if you remember back to your days of in school, when someone sent you home to memorize and come back the next day and recite, 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that this nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to the cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. The 16th president was most certainly wrong about one thing when he mused that the world will little note nor long remember what we say here. For his message is timeless. It embraces each and every time our democracy sends its own, its fathers and mothers, its sons and daughters into harm's way. It gives purpose and profound meaning each and every time this democracy mourns the loss of those who gave their lives and will give their lives so that we might continue to enjoy, and God help us all, make better and more compassionate government of, by, and for the people. Thank you. As a brief footnote, I did mention Lincoln's Gettysburg Address, 272 words. The Pythagorean Theorem, 24. The Ten Commandments, 179. The Declaration of Independence, 1,300 words. Edward Everett's Oration, 13,508. And the United States Government Regulations on the Sale of Cabbage, 26,911 words. Thank you all for being here.